This is the lecture 3 on characteristics of radio propagation. This would be the first part of this lecture, and in that part I'm just trying to give very, very introductory little equations and try to play with that and get some concepts that could be helpful for understanding of what is going on in the like wireless standards activities or whatever. So I will start the entire lecture. We'll have an introduction, calculation of the received power, effects of movements and Doppler spectrum, frequency selective fading, and the so-called classical wide sense stationary uncorrelated scattering channel modeling. I will only stay around the introduction today in this lecture. And in that, in all of these material that I have in here, I told you we have the channel. We want to characterize that. If you want to solve Maxwell's equations, that's very difficult. So we resort to a statistical modeling. And in a statistical modeling, basically I pick on some parameters. A little physics, I add a little bit to that and try to understand, have something handy. Okay? And useful. That's what we want to do. But the focal point is like, what are the important things in the physics, and then build up something around that, that we can use it as an engineer. Okay. And basically in this part, or this, if you want to call it introduction, I'm going to just pick up for calculation of the power of a single path. That's what I want to do in this lecture. When I have like a single path, oh, I can calculate the power of that. But in general, the characteristic parameters, as I told you in the last part of lecture 1, there are like 3 classic ones. In lecture 2, last part of lecture 2, I had this slide. This is a repeat of that. In classical channel modeling, we were interested in distance-power relationship, multiplied spread, and Doppler spectrum, which is rate of variations of the channel. And in addition to that, more recently, people are interested in modeling the angle of arrival and power which received from different angles. And also, they are interested in time of arrival. But all of these issues are somehow related to what? To multipath. And multipath is basically one path arriving from one signal arriving from different paths that they have different lengths and they have different angle of arrivals and they have gone through different transmissions and reflections. Okay? So each time that you get transmitted, you lose a little bit of a power. You could transmit through a ball. Each time that you get reflected, you lose a portion of your power. Each time that you get diffracted, you lose a portion of your power. Okay. But if you don't lose any of them, and you have only one path, how you can calculate the received power? And then we add those additional things later on. Okay. Now, so basically, I have like transmission between transmitter and receiver. I mean, I have this distance, D, between the transmitter and receiver, and the signal has passed through one wall. When it passes through the wall, it uses a percentage of the power. When it gets reflected, it uses a percentage of power. When it gets diffracted, it uses a percentage of. And these percentages are different for different type of wall materials which are used for the construction of these buildings. Okay? That's the same is with the scattering. But what we want to do right now is that forget about all of this and assume that you have only one path between transmitter and receiver and there is no building in here. And that one would be what? Free space propagation. Okay? So I have one path between transmitter and the receiver, and I want to know that if I send the power in here, what I would receive in here. That's it. And then later on I can add elements that comes in for reflection or diffraction or transmission. Okay? So one single path. So if I have a single path with a length D, distance between transmitter and receiver, what is the receive path? Basically, this one, we call it single path free space propagation. The equation that I have in here, most probably you have seen it in the physics in your undergraduate courses. This is the thing that they use for free space propagation. Basically, the receive power over transmit power is equal to gain of the transmitted antenna times gain of the received antenna, wavelength divided by 4 pi times d, which is the distance between transmitted and receiver, to the power of 2. So in another word, the received power is inversely proportional to a square of the distance. Okay? Also, this lambda, see, this simple equation, but for engineers, you want to develop intuition. That's number one. And number two, you want to make it simple so that you don't need to do lots of calculations. This is what engineers do, and that's what we want to do to continue. Okay? So I want just to get the intuition, what is this gain of transmitted antenna or received antenna? If I have an omnidirectional antenna, the gain is often around 1, 1.6, something like that. But if I have like a directional antenna, I'm directing my power, it doesn't go all over the place, the antenna gain can go like 10 dB up to 20 dB. So that's why I have these parameters in here. What is this lambda? Lambda is the wavelength. Wavelength is C, which is the speed of light, over F, which is frequency of my operation. For example, if you get 1 gigahertz, C is 300,000 kilometers per second. Okay, so the wavelength would be around 30 centimeters. Okay? Now, if I go to 2 gigahertz, the wavelength is what? Half of that. Okay? Which is 15 centimeters. Okay? If I go to 10 gigahertz, it's going to be 3 centimeters. And so on and so forth. So, when I go to a speed of, like, I mean, if, when I go with, like, with the optics, the wavelengths are going to be very, very, very small. Because optics are very similar to what radio signals, but the frequencies many times more. Okay? So I have the wavelengths in the order of nanoseconds and things like that for the optical signals. Okay. Now, but for radio frequencies that we are considering, if you remember, we have cellular operating at what? At 800 and 900 megahertz, which is around 1 gigahertz. PCS operating at what? Around 2 gigahertz, 1.8, 1.9. Then you have wireless LANs operating in what? 2.4 gigahertz, okay? And then you have like ultra-wideband, which is WPANs, which is operating between what? 3.4 up to 10 point something gigahertz. Okay, so we are talking about 1 to 10 gigahertz, really. That's the range that we are talking about. So the wavelengths are between what? 3 centimeters and 30 centimeters. We are developing, again, intuition, remember. Now, one of the good things to know about it is the length of the antenna goes also with the length of the what? Wavelength. So usually they have like half, quarter of the wavelength. Okay? So if I have for 1 gigahertz, for example, 30 centimeters, 1/4 of that is 7.5 centimeters. What is an omnidirectional antenna? It's just a piece of wire. So if I have a piece of wire, which is like 7.5 centimeters, that would be a good antenna for what? For 1 gigahertz type of operation. If I go now to like 2 gigahertz, like wireless LANs, I have to cut that length to what? To half. Well, I can cut it to half, so I have a good omnidirectional. Actually, one good simple design of omnidirectional is like that. You have only a piece of wire, and then you have a plate under that. That would be a very simple one. Even without the plate, it works. Okay? But this is how, as an engineer, we think about things. Wavelength is not an equation for us. It is like length of antenna for us. Okay? Something which is useful. Okay. So, if you go to that type of something that is useful, and I want to have some feeling, this is like transmitted power and transmitted power. What are the range of transmitted power, really? Range of transmitted power, like for cellular, around like less than a watt, something like that. Milliwatts, sometimes. If you go for wireless LANs and WPANs, something around 100 milliwatt. Okay, these are numbers that we have for this. And those simple antennas that I told you, omnidirectional, these gains are around one, two, something like that. Nandas, I told you. Now we talk about distances. Distances. If I have WPANs, people are talking about like 10 meters. If I have WLANs, people are talking about 100 meters. When I'm talking about like cellular, I mean like GSM covers, I think, up to like 37 kilometers, something like that, maximum radius of a cell. Okay. And if you go for like satellite, which actually this equation best fits for satellite, because that's the only one without multipath in the space. Okay, that one you're talking about like tens of kilometers, hundreds of kilometers could be. Okay, so these are like the type of thing that they have. But still, so these are all practical numbers and related things. And one good example that I have in here, power frequency of 1 gigahertz, distance of 1 meter, gains of 1.6, and a speed of light, 300,000 kilometers per second. If I put all of these things, the ratio of power transmitted to receive power to transmitted power would be a number which is very small. Often in electrical engineering, we don't measure the power with the real number. We do it in dB. So we get like 10 log of that number. If we get 10 log of that number, 10 log 10 of that ratio of these two powers, it's minus 28.4 dB. Okay? So what is the meaning of that? Meaning that now, if I had something like, let's say, a wireless LAN or WPAN, okay, transmit power was 100 milliwatt, okay? 100 milliwatt was how much? 100 milliwatt in dB is 10 log of 100 is what? 100 milliwatt, 100 over 1,000, actually. Okay? So it's going to be 20. This, they refer to that 20 dBm. Means that dB in general, I mean, I shouldn't repeat that for like electrical engineering students, but dB is the ratio of the powers, and dBm is ratio of the power to milliwatt. Okay, so when I say 100 milliwatt, 100 milliwatt over 1 milliwatt is 1,000 milliwatt. Okay, so it's like a 10, and log of 10 is like, that's what I have in here. 10 log of the transmitted power to the received power, and 20 dBm for the log of 100 was 20, 2 and then times this is 10, is 20 dBm. I have to correct. I mean, this one, this means that 20 dBm over, means 20 dB over 100 milli, 1,000, over 1 milliwatt. Okay. So I have 1 milliwatt power as the reference, then 100 milliwatt, which is in here. The difference between these two is like 20 dB. But the value of this thing, I call it 20 dBm. Okay, so this is just like a review of dB and dBm and this thing. So 1 milliwatt indeed is 0 dBm. Okay. So relative power rather than actual power is like this. So now if you now consider this type of thing, now I have like transmit power over receive power, 10 log of that, okay, for the numbers that I gave you in the example in which we had G of T equals to G of R equals to 1.6 and frequency of 1 gigahertz. This value was minus 28.4 dB. Okay? So, if my transmitted power was 20 dBm, transmit power, PT, what is the receive power? Receive power is this 20 dBm minus 28.4 dB, which is equal to minus 8.4 dBm. Okay, remember that. See, dBm minus dB is equal to dBm. Okay, means that I had like transmit power in here. Transmit power was 20 dBm. Means that it was above 1 milliwatt or 0 dBm by 20 dB. Okay? Now, this is like transmitted power, PT. Then the received power is 28 under this one. 28.4 dB under this. This is power received, which is like minus 8.4 dB below zero, which is the same as minus 8.4 dBm. Okay. I think I like this picture. Always it is. Always for people who look in the first glance, they say that receive power is dBm minus dB equals, I mean, you're mixing, I mean, in physics, it looks that you're mixing the units. But you're not mixing the units. Okay? Because you have reference to reference. That's what I have in this figure in here. Okay? So, that's how you calculate the receive power then. Okay? Now, what is the usefulness of this receive power that you receive? If you get like an IEEE 802.11, for example, original one, the threshold for operation is like minus 80 dBm. The standard gives it to you. Okay? The standard specifies that you have to work up to minus 80 dBm. What was the distance in this example? Distance was equal to 1. So if it is in free space, I can increase that distance until this received power goes lower and lower, arrives to minus 80 dB. And then I said that was the coverage. Okay? This is how I use this simple equation. Okay? That's the basic concept of this. This is a very, very useful equation. But still, engineers are lazy, to tell you the truth. They don't like this type of, I mean, replacing like GT, GR, NANDA, remembering NANDA is C over F. I can never remember this thing. I'm not a good engineer, but... So, what they do, engineers, is that they try to avoid this and find an easier equation or something like that to calculate this like handy, very quickly. So, in order to do that, number one, they come and they say that, okay, I have all these strange numbers like PT, say PT, PR, GT, GR, NANDA, 4 pi, D. But the only parameter which is changing in here, one is this PR, receive power, and the other one is this D, the distance. Huh? So why not I combine the transmit power, GT, GR, lambda, and I define one parameter for all of them. And what are you interested in? You want to know that if your distance is whatever, what is the received power? I keep those two alive. I combine all of these as one number. Okay? So this number, they call it P0. Because actually P0 is the received power at 1 meter. If I put D equal to 1 meter, I put PT comes in here, I have the, and call it P1 or P0, receive power at 1 meter, then I have one single number which represent all of these stuff, okay? And then my received power would be P0 divided by D square only. Do you follow me? This is what you have done. So your P received was something like P transmit times GT, GR, times lambda over 4 pi, times D squared. This is what you had. So what you do, you say that I make it PT, GT, GR, times lambda over 4 pi squared, everything divided by D squared. And this thing, I call it P0. Then my life is very easy. I'm a real engineer. P0 over D squared. This is what? Received power in a path, in free space. For any path of length L, no matter what, if nothing else happens, this is the received power related to power at 1 meter, received. And this is 1 meter power, and this is the distance. And then again, power in the electrical engineering, it changes so extensively from very, very small numbers to very, very large numbers that often we use what dB for that. So then if I want to use this thing in the dB form, I have to get the 10 logs in there. Okay, if I get the 10 log from both sides of this thing, I have 10 log of transmit power equals to 10 log of P0 minus 20 log of distance, D. Is that right? This is received power in dB. Power at 1 meter in dB and 20 log of D. Okay? Then, with that, I can calculate things maybe easier in some senses. Okay? So if I get this equation, which I can write it also in this form, P received in dB equals to P0, which is power at 1 meter, in dB minus 20 log of D. This log 10 of D. Huh? This is good. This is engineering. Huh? So I do one time in my lifetime power in 1 meter. From my last example, if you go to the computer, I had, like, for example, power received in 1 meter distance for the, in general, was 28.4, and then for 802.11 with transmit power of 20 dBm, I had P0 in dB was equal to minus 8.4 dB. Is that right? That was the example that I had in the last page. See, this was the example that I had in here. In here, the example that I had for 20 dB transmitted power, I had minus 0.84 dB received power at 1 meter. Okay, and I call this thing now P0 dB. Receive power at 1 meter in dB. Okay, minus 8.4 something. So that's one way to do that. Okay. That's one easy way. But if I stay to this equation now, the way it is, they make it even easier than that. I will show you a little bit later. But my received power is received power at 1 meter minus 20 dB, 20 log 10 of distance. If I look at this, I can draw some rules in here. This is a constant. This is the received power. If I want to sketch them, for example, this is the distance. This is what received power received in dB. At the distance of 1 meter, this thing is what? Is 0. Distance of 1 is 0. Log of 1 is 0. So I start in here at P0 in dB. That's in the distance 1 meter. Okay. Now, if I come to the distance 10 meters, at 10 meters, what will happen to this log of 10? Is 1. So I go 20 below this. Whatever it is, I go like 20 dB below. So in here I have like 20 below that. Okay? If I go 100 meter, what will happen? What will happen if I go 100 meter? Let me just put it in here. This is like this distance, 20, and then 20 dB. And then if I go 100 meter, log of 100 is what? 2. So there would be another what? 10 dB. Another 20 dB coming down. So basically, if I put these things like in logarithmic form, means that rather than this one, I put 0, which is log of 1 meter. In here, I put 1, which is log of 10 meter. In here, I put 2, which is log of 100 meter. So rather than d in here, I have log of d. And then I will have a line in here. Okay? So the relation between received power and the distance, if I put the distance in the log form, is a linear relationship. That linear relationship is what? 20 dB per decade of distance. Do you see that? Means that if I go from 1 meter to 10 meter, I lose 20 dB. 10 meter to 100 meter, I lose another 20 dB. Okay? That's very interesting, isn't it? So I lose, in the cables, it is linear. In cable, if I go from 1 meter, if I lose 1 dB per meter, for 10 meter, I lose 10 dB. For 100 meter, I lose. Here is not like that, it's exponential. And that's why radio can go far for long distances. In here, every 20 dB, I can go one decade of distance. This is how I can go to deep space. So I have an antenna which has antenna gain of 1, omnidirectional. I put a directional antenna, which has like 20 dB. I go one decade of distance. Means that if with omnidirectional, I was going 1,000 meters, now I can go 10,000 meters. That's the beauty of radio. And then from 10,000, I can go 100,000 for another additional 20 dB. So in free space, I can go 20 dB per decade of distance. So I can go, since it's exponential, I can cover very, very long distances. That's why I do satellite communication. And then when I do satellite communication, they have these strange antenna systems, big dishes, because they have very strong antenna gains. Because when the satellite goes there, that satellite doesn't have a lot of power on board. Only a few watts. Okay? But I want to cover a very long distance. How can I do that? I can do it with good big antennas on the ground. But with a few watts, I can cover very, very long distances. Other thing that I can improve, actually, is I can change my modulation technique. Modulation technique, basically what you do, you send the signal over and over again, if you want to call it. So you send the signal 10,000 times. When you add it up 10,000 times, your noise goes 10,000 times down. So signal pops up. Okay? So that's another thing that I can do. So I can gain from my signaling by repeating and waiting. Okay? I repeat again and again, sort of. So then I can increase my distance again. Okay? So it takes time to have very little information from a long distance by waiting in time or making my antennas better and more direction. So this is how I do that. Okay? Very good. So the power doesn't change as much, really, for the reverse. It comes from the same. So very good. But now I got some rules which are very good, engineering rule. I learned this thing that if I go to this equation that I have, 10 log of transmit receive power to P0 is 20 log of D. In another word, I have 20 dB per decade of distance if I'm in the free space. And or if you want another thing, I mean, if you put 2 in here, means I double my distance, log of 2 is 0.3, times 20 is 6. So I have 6 dB for what? 6 dB for octave. So these are two numbers that I can remember. So now, how can I change these octaves? I can change the antennas. If my antenna gain goes 6 dB more, my coverage gets what? Doubled. Or I can change my transmission technique, okay, and double the distance that way. I have a transmission which is like averaging, like, okay, more at this stage. We'll learn more complex words for that later on. I'm assuming nobody knows anything in electrical engineering. I usually start from that, then we build up on top of that. Okay? But intuition is the core. Another issue that I wanted to discuss is now the timing. How long would it take to go from one place to another place? That's not embedded in this equation. I want to come back in here now again. Now, in here I have distance D. Okay? And if I have distance D, the speed of the light is how much? 300,000 kilometers per second. 300 kilometers per second, then the time that it takes to go from one location to another location is distance divided by speed. So D over C with this 300,000 kilometers per second gives me 3 nanoseconds per meter. Is it? Means that for every meter of distance, I have a delay, absolute delay, which is how much? 3 nanoseconds. So if I have 10 meter distance, what should be the delay? Like 30 nanoseconds. Huh? Do you remember about multipad spread? I said, like, I send one pulse, it bounces over the building. These paths are in the order of distance, really, almost. They are like 2 times distance, something like that, huh? So I send one pulse, I receive many pulses, but if I'm in the indoor area, which is like 100 meter distance, what is the distance difference between the first one and the last one? Like another 100 meter? 100 meter is how much in nanosecond? 300 nanosecond. So, multipath spread means I send a pulse and I receive many pulses. In the indoor areas, is around what? 300 nanoseconds. Okay. If I go to the cellular environment, what was the distances in cellular? Around 10 kilometers, let's say. For 10 kilometers, how much is this? Is 30 microseconds. Huh? Because 3 nanosecond per meter and 10 kilometers is 10,000 meters. So when I'm talking about multipath profile that I'm just collecting in the urban areas, my spread of the multipath means I send a pulse and it cuts all over the place. How much it goes? Up to like several microseconds. When I come in indoor, several hundreds of nanoseconds. So depending on the area, it changes. Okay? This is what I call like intuition, by getting the simple equations and going to other like numbers. That intuition is very important. Okay, so this is for like 3 nanoseconds. So I have two rules now, okay? One rule is that in terms of nanosecond for the multipath spread, for example, or for the distance measurement, and then I'm talking about decade of distance or octave in terms of power. And I find two simple, easy rules as an engineer to remember. Rule number one is that distance is like, I mean, at 1 gigahertz at least, it is, or for anything, it's like 3 nanoseconds per meter. I remember that. And then I remember that in free space for the path, I have 20 dB per decade of distance, or I have 6 dB per octave of distance. Okay? These are like my more or less like common senses. I don't want to go further in there, and in this, that could be like the end of my lecture, but I will just give you some examples to use this too. Okay? I gave you an example for the power of the what? Of the 802.11. Okay, I want to elaborate on that a little bit more. I told you that transmitted power was what? In dB. In dB, I'm not good in notations, was 20 dBm. And then I told you that minimum acceptable received power was how much? P received minimum in 802.11 was something like minus 80 dBm. Okay. And then I had like P received equals to P at 1 meter, P zero in dB, minus 20 log of distance. Okay, so if, and this one was minus 8.4 dB m, that's what I had before, this P zero. This is minus 20 log of distance. And then P received, the minimum is minus 80 dBm. So this is roughly, I have like log of distance equals to 8.4 minus, this is 71.6 divided by 20. Okay? Which is equal to something like what? 3.5, something like that. 3.56, something like that. Okay? So D equals to what? 10 to the power of 3.5. So the distance that I can cover in free space is 10 to the 3.5. 10 to the 3 is what? 1,000. 10 to the 4 is 10,000. So it's several kilometers. You calculate that, in free space. Accepted? So this is a sort of like coverage in free space of 802.11. But a standard is for what? For 100 meter. What is going on? Okay? That's for single path. For multipath, I cannot cover as much. So that's what we will discuss later on. Like how to do that later on. That why, how does it reduce it? So this is one thing. The other thing, I mean, I want to just, very simple equation I gave you, but I want to give you some ideas. Okay, so The other example that I want to give you, another example, is like, this is like a frequency bands. Like for cellulars, I had like around 1 gigahertz. For ultra-wideband, up to like 10 gigahertz. You remember, we talked about that. Is that right? Now, let's say that, I mean, the power that you're sending for all of them is around the same thing. Let's say transmitted power is, again, 100 milliwatt, which is like 20 dBm. Now, you go from the beginning to the end, how much would be the difference in the received signal strength? This is in the frequency domain now. What would be the difference in the received signal strength? See, received signal strength is inversely proportional to what? To the lambda. I mean, to the F square. If we come back to the, well, I have it in here. So your received signal is P received equals to P transmit GT GR lambda, which is over 4 pi times D square. But this lambda is what? C over F. Okay, so this is inversely proportional with F squared. Okay, so if I go from 1 to 10, and if I go to the logarithmic form, actually, which is better, if I get for 1, this is 1 decade of frequencies. So I will have how much difference in the power? For 1 decade of frequency. Frequency is just like distance. So you will have like 20 dB. 20 dB difference between the powers in here. So if I have 100 milliwatt or anything transmitted power at 1 gigahertz, I was receiving something. At 10 gigahertz, I receive what? 20 dB below that. Below that. Again, if I put these things in the logarithmic form, the line would be like a line in terms of frequency. So if I come in here and I put frequency like 10 log of frequency, and in here I have like power, received power in dB, then I have a line like this. And this is frequency, like whatever. This is log of that frequency. So it is frequency of 1 is 0, and then 10 is 1, 100 is in here, etc., etc. So there's a line, a slope of this is 20 dB, a slope. So as I'm increasing my frequency, one time I told you the antenna will be what? Related to lambda. Antenna gets smaller and smaller, but received signal gets weaker and weaker. Okay? Relative received signal. If I have the same rule for propagation. Okay? And what is that reduction? Again, 20 dB per decade. So if I want to design like a receiver which works from 1 hertz to 10 gigahertz, wow. But if I want to design a receiver which is from 1 gigahertz to 10 gigahertz, that's easier. Okay. So if I change the center frequency, okay, the bandwidth proportion to the center frequency is a very important issue for the ease of design. Because if I have too much difference in the power at the beginning and the end of the spectrum, I have to have a more careful design for that system. Okay? But on the other hand, I can relate these things also to the coverages. So if I have an ultra-wideband system working at 10 gigahertz, and I have another one working at center frequency of 1 gigahertz, the coverage of these two are 20 dB different. And 20 dB in free space means 1 decade of distance. means that we don't have, in indoor open areas is like free space. If you have no wall, is like free space. So if I have an ultra wideband system which covers 10 meter at 10 gigahertz, it covers 100 meters at 1 gigahertz. And these are the things that we want to develop somewhat, some sort of intuition about it. Okay, and then we develop more accurate model later on. But the intuition for the simple things are more important for like general decisions, philosophical decisions, of which way to go, how to think. The specific ones are for what? For engineering designs, specific engineering design. But this one, I mean, at this time, at this stage, I mean, what I tried to do, in fact, in this part of lecture, which I wanted to keep it very short, around like half an hour or something, what I did, I basically took this basic equation in physics, okay, and I developed some engineering rule of thumbs out of that. Rule of thumb number one, what, and first of all, was the meaning of this thing. What is the use of this thing for us engineers? This one will tell us that for a path of length d in free space, I'm losing 20 dB per decade of distance, or 6 dB for octave of distance. Okay. Then we said that in frequency also, for octave of frequency, I have 6 dB penalty. So if I go from 1 gig, so I have like cellular systems at 1 gig, okay, PCS at 2 gig. What is the difference in coverage? 6 dB. 6 dB is the difference in coverage. Okay, 60, what do you mean by 6 dB in coverage? You can translate that if you want to have the same coverage, you need to have 6 dB more power. 6 dB is 4 times more power. If you're looking at the cover time of power of the battery, 4 times longer at 800 or 900 megahertz. So basically this particular simple equation is giving me some intuition to relate the important parameters in cellular networks, which are coverage, frequency of operation, battery life, these three more very important issues. Okay? With very simple rules. And on top of that, we just use this simple equation that gives me this intuition that whenever you are talking about the distance, you are talking about 3 nanoseconds per meter. I mean, the delay associated with 1 meter is 3 nanoseconds. It's easier than remembering the speed of light and dividing those things. And with that introduction, I think you have like two problems which are very related to these things. So in your problems, in your homework problems, what you do is that you take this simple equation that we had, you just play with that to compare different standards, like at the beginning, end of the minute, see that how much dB difference is in there. And those dB differences related to the battery, you will understand how important it is. Related to the coverage, you will know how important it is. Okay? And those are two simple questions, actually, for next week. Simple problem. Now, do you have any question? If you don't, then what I do in the next week, I start the second part of this lecture, in which now we talk about the cases that now we have more than one path. Okay, we have multi-path. How can we calculate the received power? And then we talk about how we can model it. And we continue to talk about how we can model the variations of the channel. That's a new thing. And then I give you like some programs that you can simulate it. With that, we will close this lecture.